Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Images of bearded men in crisp white or pastel-colored kurtas and pajamas ending just above their ankles inundated Indian media towards late March this year. A week before that, on 24th March, the government had announced a complete nationwide lockdown due to the coronavirus pandemic. But the group, who were found to be members of the Tablighi Jamaat, were found guilty of holding an international congregation or meeting at their Nizamuddin headquarters, hosting over 3,000 preachers between 13th and 15th of March. The meeting soon emerged as a major hotspot in the country. The Jamaat defended itself, saying that the government had on 13th March categorically said that the coronavirus wasn't a health emergency. But it didn't matter to most. In less than 24 hours of the controversy, headlines accusing the Jamaat of Corona Jihad made their way into our drawing rooms. The mainstream media had a field day. While this might have been the first time many were hearing of the organization called the Tablighi Jamaat, it had existed for over 90 years before that, spread across the length and breadth of the entire globe. Senior journalist and author Ziaus Salam traces precisely this vast history in his book Inside the Tablighi Jamaat. Founded by Deoband's Maulana Muhammad Ilyas in 1927, this Muslim Sunni reform body encourages Muslims to look within. The need of the hour, as the author points out, was for Muslims to be more aware of the religion, its tenets, and to spread the word of God, not so much amongst those belonging to other religions, but to Muslims themselves who had lost touch with the religion. Their philosophy is that you must clean up your own house before you invite other people to it. The Tablighi Jamaat is today perhaps the largest Muslim organization across the world and has its footprints on several continents. Its membership is fixed at 80 million, but the author calls it a conservative estimate since it has an open-door policy. There are so many who flux in and out of this organization, making it nearly impossible to keep a head count. What happens when such a mammoth organization is painted with the singular brush of being selfish, irresponsible, uncivilized, uncouth, and for many even anti-national? Ziaus Salam asks the reader to check their biases and challenges the convenient notions fed by the media about the Tablighi Jamaat. Salam delves deep into the organization's history and also rightly reminds the readers that it was precisely members of the Tablighi Jamaat who were one of the first ones who, despite being subjected to the vilest of abuses, returned from quarantine only to donate their plasma to save lives of people whose names or religions they did not know. But this book isn't an uncritical analysis of the Tablighi Jamaat. The one standout feature of this body is that its insistence to keep itself detached from worldly affairs. Self-admittedly, the Jamaat only concerns itself with matters beyond the sky and under the earth. But the book raises important questions about what does it really mean to be an inward-looking organization. It doesn't just question whether it is even wise to be an apolitical religious body in these increasingly polarizing times, but whether it is even possible to be apolitical for a minority religion in India. Can an organization truly claim to be looking within when it has a blinkered vision, oblivious to the lived realities and the struggles of its community members? The Tablighi Jamaat's splendid isolation from the world of politics and society ended abruptly on 30th March. It was clear that the body, which had chosen to bury its head in the ground all these years, was taken aback and could not quite fathom what had hit it. The book is critical of the Jamaat's inability to take and articulate a position on any matter even remotely political pertaining to the community, from the Triple Talaq issue to the Babri Masjid Ram Janmabhoomi controversy. Not just that, the Jamaat has stayed mum on issues of socio-economic welfare of the community, as well as the spate of hate crimes and lynchings that have taken place against Muslims in the last 5 years. This stands in stark contrast to other prominent Muslim bodies like the Jamiat Ulema Hind and the Jamaat-e-Islami, which have consistently made sure their voice is heard. There is much to be said on all these matters, but in not taking a stance, the Tablighi Jamaat reiterates its original tenet. the distinction between matters of the world and the hereafter. By drawing comparison with other religious bodies, Ziaus Salam makes it easier for the reader to understand just how unique the Tablighi Jamaat is in their approach towards religion and religious philosophy. The author also critiques the highly restrictive outlook of the organization towards women Jamaatis, how it is the men who almost exclusively occupy their masjids. Oftentimes, in most analysis of religious schools of thought, the women question occupies a peripheral position and is only addressed in touch and go. But it is good to see Salam dedicate a full chapter to it. There's a popular sentiment gaining ground among members of the Tablighi Jamaat over the last two decades or so that the Quran is a thing for the intellectuals and the scholars to understand, interpret and teach to the common person, not for ordinary people to do it for themselves, and this stands in inherent contradiction with the Tablighi Jamaat's philosophy that the Quran should be used as a guiding light and a moral compass to lead their lives. How do you do that if you aren't allowed to understand the book for yourself? The author asks. Not just this, Salam also criticizes the abhorrence of and resistance to everything new that the Tablighi Jamaat espouses, including technology. I did feel that the book doesn't adequately address what was a major fallout of the Tablighi Jamaat episode in India, the demonization of ordinary Muslims in different parts of the country. Muslim fruit vendors in Uttar Pradesh not being allowed to do their job, or a Muslim man in Himachal Pradesh having to commit suicide after allegedly facing immense harassment and bullying by the villagers. There were ample such news reports of harassment across the country, and I did think that it deserved more space in the book. But in barely 250 pages, the book is able to successfully trace the history and trajectory of the Tablighi Jamaat, from Mewat to Pakistan to Bangladesh, England, North America, Central Asia and Southeast Asian nations. It is a well-researched book that doesn't shy away from asking the uncomfortable questions to the reader as well as members of the Tablighi Jamaat. This video is part of a new series that The Print has launched where we will be reviewing latest and upcoming books. Do send us your suggestions, and if you liked this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on social media. For The Print, this is Fatima Khan.